In this spring of 1953, the free world weighs one question above all others: the chances for a just peace for all people. To weigh this chance is to summon instantly to mind another recent moment of great decision. It came with that yet more hopeful spring of 1945, bright with the promise of victory and of freedom. The hopes of all just men in that moment, too, was a just and lasting peace. The 8 years that have passed have seen that hope waver, grow dim, and almost die. And the shadow of fear, again, has darkly lengthened across the world. Today, the hope of free men remains stubborn and brave, but it is sternly disciplined by experience. It shuns not only all crude counsel of despair, but also the self-deceit of easy illusions. It weighs the chances for peace with sure, clear knowledge of what happened to the vain hopes of 1945. In that spring of victory, the soldiers of the Western Allies met the soldiers of Russia in the center of Europe. They were triumphant comrades in arms. Their peoples shared the joyous prospect of building, in honor of their dead, the only fitting monument, an age of just peace. All these war-weary peoples shared, too, this concrete, decent purpose: to guard vigilantly against the domination ever again of any part of the world by a single, unbridled, aggressive power. This common purpose lasted an instant and perished. The nations of the world divided to follow two distinct roads: the United States and our valued friends, the other free nations, chose one road. The leaders of the Soviet Union chose another. The way chosen by the United States was plainly marked by a few clear precepts which govern its conduct in world affairs. First, no people on earth can be held as a people to be an enemy. For all humanity shares a common hunger for peace and fellowship and justice. Second, no nation's security and well-being can be lastingly achieved in isolation, but only in effective cooperation with fellow nations. Third, every nation's right to a form of government and an economic system of its own choosing is inalienable. Fourth, any nation's attempt to dictate to other nations their form of government is indefensible. And fifth, a nation's hope of lasting peace cannot be firmly based upon any race in armament, but rather upon just relations and honest understanding with all other nations. In the light of these principles, the citizens of the United States define the way they propose to follow through the aftermath of peace, of war, toward true peace. This way was faithful to the spirit that inspired the United Nations to prohibit strife, to relieve tensions, to banish fears. This way was to control and to reduce armaments. This way was to allow all nations to devote their energies and resources to the great and good task of healing the war's wounds, of clothing and feeding and housing the needy, of perfecting a just political life, of enjoying the fruits of their own toil. The Soviet government held a vastly different vision of the future. In the world of its design, security was to be found not in mutual trust and mutual aid, but in force. Huge armies, subversion, rule of neighbor nations. The goal was power superiority at all costs. Security was to be sought by denying it to all others. The result has been tragic for the world and for the Soviet Union. It has also been ironic. The amassing of Soviet power alerted free nations to a new danger of aggression. It compelled them in self-defense to spend unprecedented money and energy for armament. It forced them to develop weapons of war now capable of inflicting instant and terrible punishment upon any aggressor. It instilled in the free nations, and let none doubt this, the unshakable conviction that as long as there persists a threat to freedom, they must, at any cost, remain armed, strong, and ready for the risk of war. It inspired them, and let none doubt this, to attain a unity of purpose and will beyond the power of propaganda or pressure to break now or ever. There remains, however, one thing essentially unchanged and unaffected by Soviet conduct. This unchanged thing was the readiness of the free world to welcome sincerely any genuine evidence of peaceful purpose, enabling all peoples again to resume their common quest of just peace. And the free world still holds to that purpose. The free nations, most solemnly and repeatedly, have assured the Soviet Union that their firm association has never had any aggressive purpose whatsoever. Soviet leaders, however, have seemed to persuade themselves or tried to persuade their people otherwise. And so it has come to pass that the Soviet Union itself has shared and suffered the very fears it has fostered in the rest of the world. This has been the way of life, forged by 8 years of fear and force. What can the world, or any nation in it, hope for if no turning is found on this dread road? The worst to be feared and the best to be expected can be simply stated. The worst is atomic war. The best would be this: a life of perpetual fear and tension, a burden of arms, draining the wealth and labor of all people, a wasting of strength that defies the American system or the Soviet system or any system to achieve true abundance and happiness for the peoples of this earth. Every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired signifies, in the final sense, a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and are not clothed. This world in arms is not spending money alone. It is spending the sweat of its laborers, the genius of its scientists, the hope of its children. The cost of one modern heavy bomber is this: a modern brick school in more than 30 cities. It is 2 electric power plants, each serving a town of 60,000 population. It is 2 fine, fully equipped hospitals. It is some 50 miles of concrete pavement. We pay for a single fighter plane with 500,000 bushels of wheat. We pay for a single destroyer with new homes that could have housed more than 8,000 people. This is, I repeat, the best way of life to be found on the road the world has been taking. This is not a way of life at all, in any true sense. Under the cloud of threatening war, it is humanity hanging from a cross of iron. These plain and cruel truths define the peril and point the hope that come with the spring of 1953. This is one of those times in the affairs of nations when the gravest choices must be made if there is to be a turning toward a just and lasting peace. It is a moment that calls upon the government of the world to speak their intentions with simplicity and with honesty. It calls upon them to answer the question that stirs the hearts of all sane men. Is there no other way the world may live? There is before all peoples a precious chance to turn the black tide of events. If we fail to strive to seize this chance, the judgment of future ages will be harsh and just. If we strive but fail and the world remains armed against itself, it at least will need be divided no longer in its clear knowledge of who has condemned humankind to this fate. The purpose of the United States in stating these proposals is simple. These proposals spring, without ulterior motive or political passion, from our calm conviction that the hunger for peace is in the hearts of all people, those of Russia and of China, no less than of our own country. They conform to our firm faith that God created man to enjoy, not destroy, the fruits of the earth and of their own choice. They aspire to this. The lifting from the backs and from the hearts of men of their burden of arms and of fear, so that they may find before them a golden age of freedom and of peace. Thank you.